This is a production of World Video Bible School. To God be the glory.
Hello, welcome to Lesson 18 in our study of the parables of Jesus. And I hope that you not only are studying the parables, that's not good enough, but you're also trying to apply these principles to your life. If we had all studied the parables, gleaned the principles therefrom, apply them to our lives, you think about what a better world this would be. And so then that's what we want to do. We want to learn, sure, from the parables, but we want to also make application. Just a brief review here on the interpretation of parables and the rules involved in doing that. Now, if someone should ask you, well, how are you going to go about interpreting a parable? What would you say? I hope that you've already picked up on it. Number one, we want to consider the historical setting. What is the setting? For instance, in the case of the rich fool, the historical setting is that a man interrupted the Lord during his teaching to say, Lord, cause my brother to divide his inheritance with me. And out of that grew a tremendous parable of the rich fool, showing that a man's life is not to consist of the things which he possesseth. Then, of course, consider the context. That's true with any study, not just the historical setting, but the entire context. Then look for the main lesson that is taught. Somewhere there's a lesson there, a main lesson that is to be taught. For instance, in the rich fool, you're not to trust in material goods, but rather be rich toward God. And if you're not rich toward God, you're going to be lost. That's the main lesson. And then number four, realize that no point of doctrine can be based on a parable only. The word parable, parable, means to throw down beside. So the Lord is throwing down beside certain truths, these parables to illustrate those truths. And then number five, realize that every figure in a parable does not have a specific meaning. Now some people have pressed this totally out of context, and thus they've come up with some of the weirdest interpretation of parables you've ever heard. Well, you don't want to be guilty of that, and neither do I, so we want to consider the main point and make sure that we glean the main point. Now, sometimes in parables, the Lord says, this represents this, this represents this, this represents this. That's fine. When that takes place, then we certainly want to make the right application. Well, today, we want to study the parable of the sower. And this is found in Matthew 13, 3 through 9, and then the Lord explains it in verses 18 through 23. It's also found in Mark 4, 3 through 9, and the Lord explains it in Mark 4, 13 through 20. And then it's also found in Luke 8, 4 through 15. So it's found in Matthew, Mark, Luke. And we want to study this great parable. The theme is the different classes of hearers of God's Word. The main lesson is to show the power of the seed, that is, the Word of God, but also its dependency on the soil into which it is sown. Now, friends, the seed, the Word of God, is powerful. This seed right here will get the job done if and only if the soil is good. And so you and I, we've got to watch our hearts. Notice, Jesus teaches this parable from a boat. Now, he might have seen a farmer going forth to sow seed on a hillside. Now, this we don't know. But here he is out in the Sea of Galilee, and he's looking back toward the crowd. And, of course, out here on the hillside, he could have seen a farmer going forth to sow the seed, and he could have said, behold, a sower goeth forth to sow. And then from that, teach this great parable. This parable might best be called the parable of the souls. Why? Because it deals with different kinds of hearts and their response to the Word of God. You know, we are to prepare our hearts for God's word. Ezra 7:10, and I hope that you'll remember Ezra 7:10. What a powerful verse. Take time right now to write it down and make up your mind that you're going to remember this verse, and if you can, even commit it to memory. For Ezra had prepared his heart to seek the law of the Lord. Now notice, he realized his obligation to prepare his heart. He realized his obligation then to seek the law of the Lord. And he goes on to say, and to do it. He realized his obligation not only to seek it, but to do it. And then notice, and to teach Israel statutes and judgments. Notice, he realized even after he had learned the law of the Lord, he had an obligation to share it. Do you feel that obligation? Do you go about trying to prepare your heart to receive the law of the Lord? You must do that, and I must do it. The Bible teaches in Proverbs 4:23, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. How are you keeping your heart? Now, when we say heart, we're not talking about the blood pump. We're talking about the inner man. That's what we're talking about. You're to keep the intellect, the will, always fertile for the word of God. You're to have the attitude, speak, Lord. Thy servant will obey. Tell me what you want, Lord. I'll do it. Yeah, but what if you don't understand it, Wesley? Do it. I've had people tell me, I don't see the sense in baptism. Well, now, I'll just be honest with you. God didn't ask you if you saw the sense in it. He just simply told you and me that it's part of the plan of salvation and that you and I, we're to submit to His will. See, our will is to be submitted to God's will. And when the Lord says we're to be baptized for the remission of sins, to be placed into the body of Christ in order to be saved, we better listen to Him. You see, it's a matter of the heart being right and our attitude to speak, Lord, thy servant will obey. This parable shows the power that's in God's word. In Romans 1:16, Paul said, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Also, the Lord realized the power that was in God's word when he gave the great commission, Mark 16:15. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Why preach the gospel to every creature? Because Jesus knew what the gospel would do for them. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. He knew that. And you and I, we can know it as well when we study the Bible. Romans 10:17, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You can't be saved without faith. I cannot be saved without faith. But faith comes by hearing God's word. Notice God's design, 1 Corinthians 1, beginning with verse number 18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. See, some people think it's foolishness. Why, that's stupid to think you got to preach Jesus Christ died for the world and that people have to put their faith in Him to be saved. That's stupid. Well, you may hold that view. But that's not God's view. It's not the Bible view. It's not my view, and it can't afford to be your view. But unto us which are saved, notice, it is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise and bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God, it pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. Now the Lord did not say foolish preaching, but the foolishness of preaching. I've heard a lot of foolish preaching. People get up and tell stories, and they read from creed books, and they read from newspapers, and they never get around to letting God get a word in edgewise from the Bible. Well, that's foolish preaching. You and I need to base our preaching upon a thus saith the Lord. Well, major point number one, Luke 8, beginning with verse 4. And when much people were gathered together and were come to him out of every city, he spake by a parable. A sower went out to sow. his seed. And as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down, and the fowls of the air devoured it. Now notice, the Lord is going to explain this. And when we turn to Luke 8, beginning with verse 11, he explains it. He says, now the parable is this. The seed is the word of God. Now we know what the seed is. He tells us, those by the wayside are they that hear. Then cometh the devil and taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. Notice the seed is the word of God, not a direct operation of the Holy Spirit. There are those who have the attitude, well, now I want to be saved and I'm going to wait for God to help me. So when God gets ready for me to be saved, he'll send a direct operation of the Holy Spirit and move me in such a way that I couldn't resist it if I wanted to. They better read the Bible. Here's a parable illustrating how God reaches lost men. Here's a parable illustrating the power that's in God's word. Here's a parable also illustrating the responsibility of the hearer and how he's got to guard his own heart. Notice the devil knows the power that's in God's word because he tries to remove the word lest they should believe and be saved. Now let me read that to you again. The Bible says, those by the wayside are they that hear. Then cometh the devil and taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. I want you to notice the old devil knows the power that's in God's word. And so when someone hears the word of God, the devil wants to remove it, lest they should believe and be saved. Why, even the devil's got enough sense to realize it doesn't take a direct operation of the Holy Spirit. He realizes the power that's in the word, and if that's not the case, why is he trying to remove it? The Bible tells us why. Lest they should believe and be saved. The devil does not want the seed planted into the heart. You might get to thinking about eternity, the value of your soul, and also the importance of leaving the old devil behind. And the devil does not want that to be done. If the devil fears the word of God to this extent, and he does, shouldn't you and I be busy broadcasting the seed, spreading the seed everywhere? Because the seed is that which the devil hates and that which will destroy his influence. You and I ought to be preaching the word. Now notice the way the devil tries to remove the word from our hearts. Oh, he's slick. By false doctrine. Just mix the word of God with error and let people have it. That's what he's done. And he's deceived a lot of people by creeds. Let them write what they believe, mankind. That's what the old devil's saying. Our modern day revelation, let's give them the Book of Mormon. Let's give them the writings of Charles Taze Russell, Ellen G. White, Mary Baker Eddy, or the sayings of the Pope. And it's amazing how many people will swallow those things. Notice, the parable is this. The seed is the word of God, not the sayings of the Pope, not creeds. So then some people are deceived by the sayings of the Pope. Feelings. Oh, I'd rather have what I feel here than all the Bibles you can put in this room. No, you got to have the seed planted in the inner man, the heart. Preacher's word over the Bible. Some people take the preacher's word over the Bible. I've had people say, well, now, I can't find faith only in the Bible, but now it's there. I know it's there because my preacher said so. All right, get your preacher and let him tell you where it's found. See, we don't want to take the preacher's word over the Bible. Some go by their conscience. And some believe in the man and not the plan theory. Well, I love Jesus and that's all that matters. It really makes no difference what else the Bible says. Well, that's not Jesus' view. Jesus said, he that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words. Notice the Lord tied his essence with his teachings. Jesus said, why call you me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? You know, here are some in the Bible who are wayside hearers. They heard, but they didn't let it take root. In Matthew 11, beginning with verse number 20, then began he, speaking of Jesus, to upbraid the cities wherein most of his mighty works were done, because they repented not. Woe unto thee, Chorazin! Woe unto thee, Bethsaida! Woe! For if the mighty works which were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have repented long time ago in sackcloth and ashes. But I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Tyre and Sodom at the day of judgment than for you. And thou, Capernaum, which are exalted unto heaven, shall be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works which had been done in thee had been done in Sodom, it would have remained unto this day. But I say unto you, that it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the day of judgment than for thee. Oh, they had a chance to hear. Here is Capernaum exalted unto heaven. Why? Because heaven's greatest gift, Jesus Christ, was there, and they wouldn't listen to him. The seed fell on the wayside. Now, when you think about the wayside, think about a path, a hardened path, where people walk all the time to go out to the garden where the seed is going to be sown. And some of the seed that is broadcast or spread falls over on that hard path, and it will not take root. Here come the birds and so forth and remove the seed, lest they should believe and be saved. And of course, this is the situation that these people were in. And then what about Acts 7, verse 51? Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in hearts and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost as your fathers did, so do you. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? And they have slain them which showed before of the coming of the just one, of whom ye have been now the betrayers and murderers. See, it didn't do any good for Stephen to sow the seed among those Jews. They wouldn't receive it. The devil took it out of their heart because they didn't want to hear what was preached. Then some in Athens, they were wayside hearers. In Acts 17:32, and when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, and others said, we will hear thee again of this matter. See, some just mocked. They were not about to let the seed take root. Some in Corinth, in Acts 18:6, and when they opposed themselves and blasphemed, he shook his raiment and said unto them, your blood be upon your own heads. I am clean. From henceforth I will go unto the Gentiles. See, some people oppose themselves and don't realize it. They don't want the seed to penetrate their heart. Then in Acts 13:46, then Paul and Barnabas waxed bold and said, it was necessary that the word of God should first have been spoken to you, but seeing ye have put it from you and judged yourselves unworthy of everlasting life, lo, we turn to the Gentiles. Notice the emphasis is on the hearer here, folks. This is important. And not on the character of the sower. Now, hopefully the sower is going to be a good fella. But the emphasis is on the receiving of the word. We know the word is of number one quality because it's the word of God. But what about the heart? Is it ready to receive it? You know, a lot of people, they talk about the preacher. Well, he's too ugly with his attitude. Well, look at Jonah going through Nineveh. We don't endorse ugly attitudes. But look at the ugly attitude he had, and the people's hearts were receptive. So then, in this parable, the emphasis is upon the heart receiving the seed. And so we've got to make sure that we hear correctly. In Luke 8:18, take heed how ye hear. For whosoever hath, to him shall be given, and whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken even that which he seemeth to have. You know, the Lord warns over and over, take heed how ye hear. Take heed what you hear. So we're obligated not to just hear anything, but when we hear the right thing, do something about it. Now the wayside here, the seed never got into the soil. The birds came and ate it. Mark 4:4 tells us this. And it came to pass as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and the fowls of the air came and devoured it. Now, Is that the kind of heart you got? You're not going to let the seed in? Anything at all, the least little criticism, someone say, well, now, don't listen to that, and you let the seed go. You give up God's word. The devil can only take the seed after we have rejected it. See, the devil can't come along and just take the seed away from you. You got to reject it. Now, when you reject it, then the devil is going to take the seed away. Notice the wayside hearer does not understand God's word. We're told this from Matthew's account. In Matthew 13:19, when anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which receiveth seed by the wayside. Now, why do they not understand it? They've not prepared their heart. They've not investigated thoroughly. They don't want to understand it. It's not that they can't. And so the old devil just removes it from their heart. Notice the word of God is called the word of the kingdom. Now, when this word is planted in the heart and produces offspring, it produces citizens in the kingdom. And that's what John 3:3-5 tells us. And so this parable, too, kills premillennialism. All right, major point number 2. This is Luke 8:6. And some fell upon a rock, and as soon as it was sprung up, it withered away because it lacked moisture. Now notice the Lord's explanation of this in Matthew 13, beginning with verse number 20. But he that receiveth the seed in stony places, the same is he that heareth the word, and anon with joy receiveth it. Yet hath he not root in himself, but dureth for a while. For when tribulation or persecution ariseth because of the word, by and by he is offended. Then Luke 8:13 says this, they on the rock are they, which when they hear, receive the word with joy. And these have no root, which for a while believe, and in time of temptation fall away. Notice the rocky soil has no roots or moisture. Notice, if you sow seed on top of rocks, it's not going to be able to, the seed, to get down there and plant those roots very deeply. So it's not going to take much sun. It's not going to take much of anything to destroy it. Now, the parable says that they received the word, but fell away because of temptation, tribulation, and persecution. Notice they fell away, not born away. This parable proves that Calvinism, universalism, and once saved, always saved is false. You know, Calvinists want you to believe that you're either elected from all eternity to be saved or you're elected from all eternity to go to hell, and you can't make a choice. I had a preacher one time who was a Calvinist, wanted me to come and hear him. And I said, all right, if I come and hear you, and you convince me I'm in the non-elect class, and I want to come over to be in the elect class, can I change? And he said, no. I said, well, I'm not coming to hear you because you can't help me. Now listen, folks, these people right here, they heard the word, they received it, they obeyed it, and they were faithful for a while, but when temptation, persecution, and various trials came, they fell away. Now what about once saved, always saved? How did they manage to fall away? Those who teach once saved, always saved, teach you can't fall away. These fell away. Galatians 5:4 just comes right out and says, if you try to be justified by the law, you're falling from grace. And people come along and say, well, you can't fall from grace. Well, the Bible says you can. And these people fell away. What about universalism? You know, universalism says everybody's going to be saved. Well, that's not the truth here. These people fell away. This parable teaches that persecution and tribulation will arise because of the word. It shouldn't shock you that you're persecuted because of what you believe. The Bible says that's going to happen. 2 Timothy 3:12, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. So you're going to be persecuted, and so am I. The Lord has promised to help us during our temptations. Thank God for that. He made you and me this promise in 1 Corinthians 10:13. There hath no temptation taken you but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that you're able, but will with the temptation also make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Boy, I'm thankful God is that gracious. The only temptations that come my way are those that are common to man. And he's also promised me that he won't allow me to be tempted above that which I'm able to bear. And he says he'll also make a way of escape. So there's no reason for me to give up on the Lord. Notice they receive the word anon with joy. The word anon means straightway or quickly. They couldn't wait upon hearing the word of God to obey it. You ever seen people like that? I've seen people like that. Boy, they just couldn't wait. Their emotions were in this. Man, this is wonderful. I want it. I'm going to live for God. And they fall away just about as quickly as they get involved in it, because, you see, it was an emotional trip with a lot of them, an emotional high rather than true conviction. Notice they have a surface religion. They have a shallow character. All emotions and feelings. They see only the pleasant elements of Christianity. They do not want to pay a price for that which they believe. Oh, I didn't know the persecutions were going to come. I didn't know the trials were going to come. I thought this was going to be a bed of roses. No, it's not a bed of roses. And so you and I have got to understand the principle that it's not a bed of roses. Now, here are some stony ground hearers right fast. In John 6, 66 beginning, from that time many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. Then said Jesus unto the 12, will ye also go away? Then Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life. The Lord gave a hard commandment, and some of the disciples just couldn't bear it. This is more than we can take. And so they went back to walk with the Lord no more. You see, they were willing to walk with the Lord as long as everything went their way. But when things got a little tough and a little difficult and a little different than what they thought it ought to be, then they were willing to give up. In John 12, verse 42 beginning, nevertheless, among the chief rulers, also many believed on him, but because of the Pharisees, they did not confess him, lest they should be put out of the synagogue, for they loved the praises of men more than the praises of God. And so then, friends, these chief priests would not confess the Lord because they were afraid of what was going to happen to them. And then in Revelation 21:8, the fearful, they're going to be in the lake of fire just like everybody else. These are they that were Christians. And then when trials came their way because of fear, they gave up on the Lord. Well, that's the kind of hearer we're talking about when we talk about the stony ground hearers. All right, major point number 3, Luke 8:7, and some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and choked it out. Now, here's the Lord's explanation of this in Matthew 13:22. He also that receives seed among the thorns is he that heareth the word, and the care of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becometh unfruitful. Notice, he becometh unfruitful. He was fruitful at one time. Then in Luke 8:14, and that which fell among thorns are they, which when they have heard go forth and are choked with the cares and the riches and pleasures of this life and bring no fruit to perfection. Notice, these were fruitful, but as Matthew put it, they become, or he becometh unfruitful. The problem here is that the soil cannot produce both thorns and fruit. No man can serve two masters. For either he'll hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon, according to Matthew 6:24. Christianity is choked out of these people by the cares, the riches, and the pleasures of this life. The soil is rich. But notice, it will bring forth thorns or fruit, but not both. They choke each other out. Now here are some thorny ground hearers in the Bible. The rich young ruler, he allowed the riches that he had to choke religion plumb out of his life. According to Luke 18 18 through 23. The rich farmer, the parable we studied last session. I want you to notice that lo and behold, he allowed the word of God to be choked out by the material blessings that he had received. Demas, in 2 Timothy 4:10, the Bible makes the argument relative to Demas that Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world. Judas Iscariot. Think about, here's a man who walked side by side with Jesus, saw the miracles the Lord wrought. And here is a man who worked miracles himself according to Matthew 10, 1 through 7. And though he experienced all these things, he sold the Lord out. He allowed true religion to be choked out of his life by 30 pieces of silver. Say, boy, I wouldn't do that. You wouldn't. What would it take? How many of us, because we're trying to make an extra dollar that we really don't need, miss services? We gripe when the preacher preaches on giving. We don't want to support what's going on down at the local congregation. We don't want to use our talents. And we miss Wednesday night services to take the kids to the ball game. You're allowing the pleasures of this life, my friends, to choke the Word of God right out of your lives. I've seen members of the church who they'll get all wrapped up in their family, and there's nothing wrong with that if you do it correctly. And they'll take their children to the ball games on Wednesday night, and they'll do something else with the family on Sunday night. And they're not all that excited about being there Sunday morning either. They maybe go out to the lake. And then they'll do this through the entire childhood of their children. And then when the children grow up, the children are not faithful. And the parents say, I can't understand it. We took them to services. We told them about God. No, it was the way you lived. They saw where your heart was, that you really cared about the things of the world more than you cared for God. Adam and Eve sold God out for a fruit that was on a tree. Genesis 3. Gehazi was given leprosy because he wanted the material things that Naaman had brought for his healing. Well, major point number 4. Luke 8:8. And other fell on good ground and sprang up and bare fruit 100-fold. And when he had said these things, he cried, He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. Now here's the Lord's explanation of it found in Mark 4, verse 20. And these are they which are sown on good ground, such as hear the word and receive it, and bring forth fruit, some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100-fold. In Luke 8:15, he also explains it. But that on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart, having heard the word, keep it and bring forth fruit with patience. Denominational people often tell us you can't keep the word of God. Jesus said, you're good soil if and only if, out of an honest heart, you hear the word and you keep it. Notice some characteristics of the good soil as we put all this together. Number one, listens well, understands the word, accepts the word, honest, good, meaning fertile, keeps the word, and is fruitful. Now that's the kind of soil you must be and I must be. Now here are some good ground hearers in the word of God. Those about 3,000 on the day of Pentecost, when they heard the word of God preached for the first time, they were pricked in their hearts. See, that's what God's shooting at, the hearts. They were pricked in their heart and they cried out, men and brethren, what must we do? Acts 2, verse number 37. They were told the right answer, repent and be baptized, every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. I want you to notice when they did that, they were baptized in the name of Jesus for the remission of sins. They were added to the Lord's church. Lydia, in Acts 16, 14 through 15, here is a woman whose heart the Lord opened, and she attended unto those things, and she and those with her obeyed the gospel of Christ. Cornelius, I love this verse in Acts 10. Here is a man with a good heart. In Acts 10, 33, immediately therefore, he's speaking to Peter, I sent to thee, and thou hast well done that thou art come. Now watch this attitude. Now therefore are we all here present before God to hear all things that are commanded thee of God. Now, Peter, when the angel told me to send for you, I did. Now we're all here before God to hear all things that are commanded of thee by God. Speak. We want to hear the commandments of the Lord. Whatever those commandments are, lay them on us. We want to know them. Then the Bereans, they were said to be more noble than those at Thessalonica because they searched the Scriptures. Acts 17:11, they had good hearts, and many of them obeyed, according to verse 12. Then the people in Corinth, some of them, Acts 18:8, and Crispus and the chief ruler of the synagogue believed on the Lord with all of his house, and many of the Corinthians, hearing, believed and were baptized. And then in the book of Revelation, Revelation 14:13, Revelation 2:10, showing that some of these people were even faithful unto death. Friends, showing that they had a good, honest heart and they loved truth more than they loved their own life. Well, briefly, some lessons that we can learn from this parable. Notice, there is power in the Word of God. That's lesson one. Lesson two, the heart must be guarded. Lesson three, one can fall from the grace of God. Lesson four, one can harden his heart. Lesson five, we are free moral agents. Lesson six, we can have the Word of God choked out of our lives by the cares, the riches, and the pleasures of this life. Lesson seven, Satan knows the power of God's Word, and he tries to remove it from your heart and from mine. We cannot allow him to do that. Lesson eight, there is no salvation separate and apart from God's Word. The seed has got to be sown in the hearts. Number nine, we must always put God first in our lives, not the cares, the riches, and the pleasures of this life. Number 10, Christ wants all people exposed to the gospel. Number 11, one will be punished for not bearing fruit. Number 12, the seed has no power until it's sown. Number 13, we must resist Satan. And number 14, we must avoid the pitfalls of materialism. Boy, this is a powerful parable. I hope you'll continue to study it and many more, and may God bless you as you do that.
This is a production of World Video Bible School. To God be the glory.